Okay, good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. Before I introduce our topic today and our speakers, can I just ask if everyone can make sure they've muted their phone or turned it off so we don't get interruptions? So our topic today, as you can see from the presentation here, is go beyond deterrence dominant and Japan's security strategy under a new paradigm shift. As you will see from the introduction, this issue primarily involves the situation of Taiwan today. I'd like to just give a brief sort of background to how we arrived at where we are today and the context of what Taiwan represents. So the end of the Chinese Civil War took place in 1949, which is commonly also referred to as the Chinese Communist Revolution. And the nationalists that fought the communists retreated to the island of Taiwan and set up government there. No peace treaty was ever signed between those two warring powers. And the Chinese Communist Party has always maintained very forcefully that Taiwan is an integral part of China's mainland and will be united with the mainland by whatever means are necessary, including force. So this uneasy truce, if you like, has existed between the mainland and Taiwan for more than 70 years. In one way, it could be called another wound that has been festering since the end of the Second World War. The uneasy truce has gotten an awful lot more uneasy in recent months and recent years, in fact. We have, for example, China's expansion into the South China Sea and increased military exercises, which have been seen as targeting Taiwan. The United States, which is a Taiwan ally, has reiterated recently support for the democratically elected government in Taiwan. And this, of course, brings Japan's role into the equation as an ally of the US and with its own strategic interests in Asia. We have recently the comment from Mr. Taro Aso in July, Japan's deputy prime minister, saying that Japan would have to join with its US ally to defend Taiwan if China invaded. Other comments that have come out from Japan's government have also been equally forceful. So we also have at the moment, in fact, a massive military exercise taking place in and around the South China Sea with China running out warships and running exercises there, whilst the US and its allies are doing the same. So we have this classic saber rattling, gunboats are sailing, and so on and so forth, which is raising this increased concern about the possibility of military conflict. Our speakers today are from the new diplomacy initiative, and they believe that there's another approach to this, that dialogue is needed, an alternative security strategy, and one that would avoid the horrifying prospect of the world's three most powerful nations coming into military conflict. So our first speaker today is Mr. Kyoji Yanagisawa, the new Diplomacy Initiative board member and former Assistant Chief Cabinet Secretary. Our other speaker is Mr. Shigeru Handa, a defense journalist, and also Sayo Saruta, who's the new Diplomacy Initiative president. We'll have three short comments from our speakers, and then we'll open the floor to a question and answer. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
おはようございます。柳沢です。まずこういう機会を与えていただいたことに感謝申し上げまして、手短に私のプレゼンをしたいと思います。
Good morning. As introduced, my name is Yanagisawa. I would like to say, first of all, thank you very much for the opportunity today, and I would like to make some brief remarks.
スクリーンに、主なポイントをお示しましたけれども、私は今、台湾をめぐる米中の対立関係、について非常に心配をしております。
The slide displayed now shows the main points which I would like to speak to today, but I would like to share that I am extremely concerned about the potential of conflict between the US and China over Taiwan.
米中の対立、特に台湾をめぐって非常に厳しい対立になっていて、そしてもう私の認識ではそれはすでに戦争の危険水域に近づきつつあるということだと思います。そして米中が戦えば当然日本が戦場として巻き込まれることになる、そういう危機感を持っています。
So we are indeed very much concerned about the high tensions which are rising even further between the US and China. Personally, I believe that this situation is already reaching close to the danger zone of war, and there is a serious risk that indeed China and the US may go to war, enter into a conflict over Taiwan.
麻生副総理が、台湾を防衛しなければいけないということを言われたそうですけれど、私も新聞で読みましたが、台湾を防衛するということはね、中国と戦争するということなんですね。で、あの方は本当にそのことを理解しておっしゃってるのかどうか、私は甚だ疑問であり、心配するところであります。
So it seems that Deputy Prime Minister Aso did make statements about Japan needing to defend Taiwan. I also read these in the newspaper, of course. But of course, when we think about what it means to protect Taiwan, this indeed means going to war with China. And I really question and am very worried about whether Mr. Aso actually understands what this means, these implications, when he makes such a statement.
そして、台湾情勢心配している理由ですが、まず第一に今までアメリカと中国の間で対立を持ちながらも戦争に至らなかった、戦争を回避してきた、その客観的な条件が失われているということを感じています。
And in regards to why I am concerned about the situation of Taiwan going into a war, I would like to share some reasons of this. And the first is that the objective conditions which have been in place now, which have meant that although there has been tensions between the US and China, they've been able to avoid going to war, these conditions are now being lost.
そのコンディション、その条件というのは、第一に軍事バランスで見れば、90年代まではアメリカと台湾側が有利であったものが今や中国が優位に変わってきています。
And in regards to these conditions, the first is looking at the military balance. Until the 1990s, the US and Taiwanese side was overwhelmingly in the favor of that. However, this has now shifted towards being in favor of China in this balance.
二つ目に、今まで米中の台湾を含むアメリカ、中国、台湾の三者の基本的な合意はワンチャイナ、中国が一つであり、そして台湾の独立を認めないというこの合意があったわけですが、これが今、崩れてきている。特にアメリカ政府がのポリシーによって、そのワンチャイナの認識がどんどん侵食されている状況になっていると思います。
And the second condition is that the political consensus, which till now had been shared by the three parties of the US, China, and also Taiwan, in regards to, first of all, one China, and second, no recognition of Taiwanese independence, this is now being shaken. And particularly through United States government policy, this political consensus is eroding.
そしてもう一つ、台湾の人々にとっても、かつては中国と、やがて中国と統一するということは目標に持っていたわけですが、今や台湾の人々は自分を中国人とは違う台湾人であるという アイデンティティを持っているという状況になっています。
And the next reason is looking at the issue of a changing awareness or a changing identity amongst the people in Taiwan as well, seeing themselves as Taiwanese rather than as Chinese people and not wanting to see unification with China.
そして3つ目の要因として経済の面では、従来2000年代に馬英九政権なんかは、その通商、通行、通遊というね、大陸と台湾の間の交流関係とか経済依存を通じて両者の和解を図る政策を取っていたんだけれど、今それが完全に失われつつある。
And the third condition is looking at economic aspects. Until the 2000s and under the Ma presidency in Taiwan, there was the policy of the three channels of exchange with China and looking at also economic exchange. However, this is not in place at the moment.
特にアメリカ政府の政策もあって、台湾はご承知のように高性能半導体の最大のシェアを持つ生産国なんですが、これを中国から分離をしてデカプリングを進めようとしています。
And particularly looking at the U.S. government policy, as you're of course aware, Taiwan holds the largest share in regards to semiconductors. And there's the policy now of decoupling and moving this kind of technology and this exchange in regards to semiconductor technology separating from China.
しかし、こういうことで戦争が回避されてきた大きな条件が変化している、失われていると思うんですが、しかし多くの人は、しかしいくらなんでもアメリカも中国もそこまで愚かではないから戦争なんかないだろうと一般的に考えているように見えるんですね。
However, these largely significant conditions which have meant that a war could be avoided until now, despite the fact that they are changing, I believe that many people hold the kind of opinion that well, both or neither US and China would be foolish enough to actually go to war. This is the majority opinion, I believe.
しかし非常に医療者の不信感とテンションが高まっている条件の下でね、そしてお互いに台湾の周辺に軍隊を貼り付けていますから、もう全く予期しない何らかの衝突というのは起こりうると思っています。
However, amidst the increasing distrust and tensions between the two sides and the fact that they are also stationing the military around Taiwan as well means that I believe there is a significant risk of an unexpected conflict arising.
そしてどんなに軍事的には本当に取るに足らない小さな、偶発的な衝突があったとしてもね、その時に、今の精神状態から言うとアメリカも中国もここで自分が引くわけにいかないと考える可能性があるわけですね。そうすると小さな衝突が望まない大きな戦争に拡大していくという可能性は否定できないと思っています。
And looking at militarily, for example, even if something could be a very small, even accidental conflict or clash, given the psychological situation that both the US and China are in at the moment, there is a risk that neither of them would see it possible to retreat. Therefore, a very small, minor clash has the risk of expanding into a large-scale war.
ですから我々は日本としてはね、もう今一番大きな政策目標は中国を封じ込めることではなくて、いかにしてアメリカと中国の戦争を回避するようにするか、これが大きな日本の政策目標でなければならないというふうに思っています。
So we believe that the greatest policy goal now for us as Japan is not looking at how to contain China, but rather how to ensure that both the US and China can avoid a war, how a war with these two parties can be avoided.
そのために日本も抑止、この ND の提言にありますようにね、抑止だけに頼るのではなくて、外交を車の両輪としてバランスよく回していく必要があるというのが我々の基本的な考え方であります。
And as outlined in our recently published report, we believe, therefore, that Japan must not only rely on deterrence in its policy, but it must also have a policy of diplomacy with the two working together as two different wheels and holding a balance as we go forward.
ありがとうございました。
Thank you very much.
Yes, our next speaker is Mr. Handa. Thank you.
次半田さんよろしくお願いします。
はい、皆さんのお手元にあるこの紙の3ページ日本語だけで書かれているところこの内容について説明をしていきます。
So we have distributed some materials today. On the third page, there is a page in Japanese, and this is what I will be referring to as I speak today.
まず最初に3項目の説明をいたします。
And first, I would like to explain the first three categories.
1、米国の対中戦略にとって日本の協力は死活的に重要である。
1. In regards to the U.S. strategy towards China, Japan's cooperation is of vital importance.
2. 過度な対米傾斜は米中対立を加速させ、日中関係の悪化を呼び込む。
2. An excessive leaning towards the U.S. would accelerate the confrontation between the U.S. and China and lead to a deterioration in Japan-China relations.
3. 日本はミドルパワーの国々と連携して緊張緩和に踏み出すべきである。
And three, Japan should cooperate with middle power countries in order to take steps to ease tensions.
具体的にその内容について説明をしていきます。
And I would like to explain more in detail about these three points.
米国は台湾との曖昧な関係を見直し、関係を深めようとしている。しかし、太平洋を挟むことから軍事的な関与が困難である。
The United States is reviewing its ambiguous relationship with Taiwan and seeking to deepen its engagement or involvement. However, because of the Pacific Ocean in between, military engagement is difficult.
そこで第一列島線の国々を踏み台にして軍事的圧力を強めざるを得ない。中でも米軍基地が集中する日本は地政的に見て米国にとって最良の位置にある。
Therefore, it has no choice other than to use the countries which are in the first island chain as a springboard in order to increase military pressure. In particular, Japan, with its high concentration of U.S. military bases, is in the best geopolitical position from the perspective of the United States.
米中の地上発射型の中距離ミサイル保有数は1250発対0と米国が圧倒的に不利だが、米国は2023会計年度までに超音速滑空ミサイルの開発を終え、日本などへの配備が見込まれている。
The U.S. and China, if we look at the number of ground-launched medium-range missiles, it is 1250 to zero. Therefore, the U.S. is at a huge disadvantage. However, the United States is expected to complete development of its long-range hypersonic weapons, or LRHW, by fiscal year 2023, and then to deploy this both in Japan or in places including Japan.
そうなれば、米中の関係悪化は決定的となり、日中関係も悪化する。中距離ミサイルのバランスが回復することにより、米国は強硬路線に踏み出す機会を得ることになる。
And if such a thing happens, the deterioration of relations between the U.S. and China will be decisive, definitive. And Japan-China relations will also deteriorate. Restoration of the balance in medium-range missiles would give the U.S. the opportunity to take a hard line against China.
すでに述べた通り、米国は日本列島を踏み台にしなければ台湾有事に向き合えない。
And as already mentioned, it would not be possible for the U.S. to face a Taiwan contingency without using the Japanese archipelago as a springboard.
左の写真は今アメリカのロッキード・マーチン社で開発しているアメリカ陸軍の超音速滑空ミサイルの想像図です。
And the image which is included on this paper is the LRHWs, which are now under development by Lockheed Martin in the U.S. Army.
日本への米国への非協力は前例がある。
However, there is actually a precedent for Japanese non-cooperation with the U.S.
1993年から94年にかけての朝鮮半島危機の際、日本政府は米国から要請された掃海艇の朝鮮海峡派遣など1059項目の対米支援をすべて拒否した。この結果、米国は1950年に起きた朝鮮戦争と異なり、 日本を踏み台にした戦争遂行が不可能になった。
And during the Korean Peninsula crisis of 1993 to 1994, the U.S. made 1,059 requests of assistance to Japan, but the Japanese government refused all of these, including the dispatch of minesweepers to the Korean Strait. As a result, the U.S. was not able to use Japan as a springboard for war, unlike the Korean War in 1950.
米国は自国の戦死者が5万人を超えるとの見積もりとともに、戦争遂行が困難になるとの見通しから計画したヨンビョンの核開発施設の空爆を断念をした。
The United States has abandoned plans for airbombing of the nuclear facilities in Yongbyon because it has estimated that its own death toll would exceed 50,000 people and it would be very difficult to carry out such a war.
日本が取るべき道は中距離ミサイルの配備を明確に拒否し、中国に対しては日中平和友好条約を背景に国際法の遵守などを呼びかけるべきである。
So the path which Japan should now take is to clearly reject the deployment of intermediate range missiles and to call on China with the Japan-China Peace and Friendship Treaty in the background to comply with international law and other rules.
日本は地域の当事国として韓国や ASEAN 諸国と連携するとともに、インド太平洋への関与を深めつつある英国や EU とともに米中を緊張緩和の方向へ導くべきである。
As part of this region, Japan should work together with the Republic of Korea and the countries of ASEAN, as well as with the United Kingdom and the EU, which are both becoming more involved in the Indo-Pacific region, to lead us towards the direction of easing tensions between the US and China.
以上です。ありがとうございました。
Thank you very much.
And our final speaker is Ms. Saruta.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and I'm very honored to give a talk here today. I speak in English. Let me first start with a bit of introduction about the New Diplomacy Initiative. New Diplomacy Initiative, our organization is trying to bring the unheard voices beyond borders.In the diplomatic society, the voice of the Japanese government is the only voice heard as the voice of Japan. However, according to public polling, the voice of the majority of Japanese people are different from the government voice on many issues related to foreign affairs, such as the Okinawa Henoko new base construction, as well as the nuclear weapon ban treaty. Based in Tokyo and Washington, D.C., we, the New Diplomacy Initiative,are trying to carry the diversity of voices to Washington, D.C. and to the international society. In Japan, the U.S.-Japan relationship is often expressed as slavish obedience to the United States. However, when President Trump grumbled about the U.S.-Japan alliance, U.S. military bases in Japan, and military exercises,Prime Minister Abe made his largest effort to maintain them. A lot of U.S. security experts thanked Japan for that effort, which they could not have done by themselves. Recently, in Foreign Affairs, the world's most influential magazine on international affairs,An article was published titled, Japan is the new leader of Asia's liberal order. Washington must learn to follow its longtime ally in the Indo-Pacific. That's a title, long title. Right before President Biden was inaugurated, Japanese government officials,and security expert in Japan showed their concern. If the Biden administration is not tough on China, what can we do? So in reality, now, in addition to the United States itself's set strategy, Japan is pressuring the United States to take a tougher position against China. However, how is public opinion in Japan? Public polling shows the Japanese people's objective feelings about China. The left graph's question is, which is more important, the Japan-US relationship or Japan-China relationship? The largest number of people answered, both are equally important. In the right graph, Japanese people also answered, even during a US and China conflict, Japan should cooperate with China. Of course, we should tell China, human rights are important, but that is not the same as containing China militarily or decoupling the economy from China. Now, the United States is trying to get Southeast Asian countries on its side against China, but those middle and small-sized countries are telling the United States, please don't make us choose sides. The same is true for Japan. Mr. Hiroaki Nakanishi, former president of Keidanren, the Japan Business Federation, also said at a press conference, we would be troubled if we have to choose only one, US or China. This is the very basic and general feeling in Japan, although it is not well understood by Japanese politicians. Moreover, still now, I think the majority of Japanese people's feeling would be to reject war if the conflict over Taiwan were to become a real battle. We don't negate the role of military, but the deterrence-only policy cannot maintain stability and peace. We must have strong diplomatic channels and strong people's ties with China in order to keep the peace in the region. You, who are in the room, may find our latest report, Go Beyond Deterrence Dominant, Japanese Security Strategy Under a New Paradigm Shift, in your envelope. People who are watching us through internet may find it online. So please take a look at it. And if you could help us out to spread out our report, conveying these and other issues in detail, we would really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you to our speakers today. We'll now open the floor to any questions. If anyone has, just raise your hand, let me know. And anyone who has a question, please identify yourself and who you work for.
これで質疑応答に入りますが、ご質問のある方は挙手お願いします。質問の際はお名前と所属の方をお願いいたします。日本語でも大丈夫です。
While people are mulling that over, I do have a question myself, primarily for Mr. Yanagisawa. Because you served in government, I wonder if you could perhaps try and characterize for us the balance between, say, the doves and the hawks within Japan's government.
まず司会の方から一つ質問させていただきますが、柳沢さんは以前も政権の一部に一員になったということで、今の日本政府の中で、そのハト派とタカ派のバランスをどういうふうに見ているのかについての見解をお願いできますでしょうか。
Of course, I mean specifically to do with this issue over Taiwan.
具体的にこの台湾をめぐるイシューについてですが。
私は1970年から2009年まで政府で防衛の仕事をやってきたんですね。 ただその時にずっと私がお仕えしてきた私のボスである自民党の政治家の方々は皆鳩であったと思います。
So I was working within the government in charge of defense issues until the year 2009. And at the time, or in, during that whole period, the LDP politicians who I was working under, I would characterize them as all having been doves.
その人たちはみんな、昔の、戦争を経験した世代の方々だったんですね。だからもう戦争は絶対にしちゃいかんというのは議論の余地のない前提として彼らの中に認識されていた。それが今そういう人たちがだんだんいなくなってきて、つまり戦争を体験したがゆえの鳩である人々がいなくなっていると思っています。
And they were of course all of the generation who directly experienced war. Therefore I believe that they shared a basic recognition, a basic understanding that was at the foundations that we must avoid war, and you know this is something which is not debatable. And however, these kinds of people are no longer, in these positions. So these doves who experience war themselves are not around.
で、まあそれは日本が実は日本我々が戦争っていうとね、75年前に終わった戦争のことを言うんですね。で、その後日本は75年間戦争してないので、それはいいこと、それは良いことなのですけれども、しかしだからといって戦争というものがどういうものかというね、戦争のリアリティの認識まで失った、たかが今羽ばたいている、その状況が大変、危険だと私は思います。
However, actually, in Japan, of course, when we refer to war, it generally refers to the war which ended 75 years ago. And the fact that Japan, during the period since then, has not been directly at war is, of course, a good thing. However, it has led to the reality now that the hawks who do not have an understanding of the reality of war, actually what war is, are now spreading their wings. And that is something which is extremely concerning.
台湾について言うと非常に台湾も日本もお互いに好意的であるとは思います。
In regards to Taiwan, I think that Japan and Taiwan, of course, both have a very positive relationship toward each other.
しかし日本の場合、日中関係を考えるともう一つ別の要因があって、それは日中国交回復から75年経つわけですけれども、50年経つわけですけれど、50年前の中国っていうのは貧しい国だったんですね。そして日本が昔そこで悪いこともしたのでね、だから日本は日中国交回復とともに中国を援助してあげた、そういう関係があったわけですね。
However, in the case of Japan's relationship with China, or since the recovery of diplomatic relations between the two 50 years ago, at that time, China was a country which was very poor, and Japan had also been responsible for doing bad things in China in the past as well. Therefore, at the time of the recovery of relations, or the building of diplomatic relations between the two, Japan was giving aid to China.
で、それはね、日本にとってみれば、なんていうか、上から目線で中国を見ることができる非常に居心地のいい関係が出会ったと思うんですが、今や完全に立場が逆転して、中国の方がはるか上から目線で日本を眺めているようなね、そういう中国に対する非常に複雑な私はチャイナコンプレックスと言ってますが、非常に複雑な感情が日本にはある。そして中国にはかつて侵略を受けたということへのウルサンチマンがある。こういう感情的な対立が一つ台湾政策をめぐっても、まあ、台湾政策を焦点として今なんていうかそういう感情が現れている、そういうタカ派が今出てきているんだと思います。
And in regards to Japan, this meant that Japan could be in a very comfortable position of looking down on China from that time of the building of relations. Of course, now it is completely the opposite situation. Given China's position now in the world, it is China which, in a way, is looking down upon Japan. But I believe that this means that Japan has a very complicated emotions towards China, which I refer to as a China complex. On the part of China, of course, there is also the aspects regarding Japan's past invasion of China, the historical aspects as well, which means that it's a very emotional issue between both of the two countries. And I think that the Taiwan policy, the Taiwan situation now is sort of in a way being used as the focal point for where these different emotions are coming to. And this is where the hawks are coming out to play.
Sorry, long, but I'm ambiguous.
No, thank you very much. I do have a couple of questions that have come in online. I think the first one would be for Mr. Yanagisawa, and also for what anyone else who would like to respond to the question is welcome. This is from Andrew Sharp, a journalist at Nikkei Asia. He asked, Defense Minister Kishi said on August 3rd that Japan plans to deploy security units, mid-range ground-to-air ammunition units, and ground-to-ship guided ammunition units on Ishigaki-jima over the next few years. About 500 to 600 troops are expected to be deployed. What is your interpretation of this move? Will this act as a deterrent for any possible Chinese invasion of Taiwan? And I guess to add the point that Ishigaki-jima is just 300 kilometers or so from Taiwan.
はい、次、オンラインの方で届いている質問で、まず日経アジアのアンドリュー・シャープ記者からの質問です。8月3日に岸防衛大臣が、これから日本が石垣島で警備部隊、中距離、地対空弾部隊、そして地対艦誘導弾部隊などを今から配備するというような発表をされました。石垣島の方で500から600人ぐらいの部隊が配備されるだろうというふうに言われていますが、この動きをどういうふうに解釈されるのか、これが中国の台湾に対する侵略の抑止になるのでしょうか。まず柳沢さん、そして他の皆さんも、もし何かあればお願いいたします。
専門である半田さんがまず。
じゃあ、いいですか。
Sure. Yes, please.
岸防衛大臣が8月に言ったその石垣島への地対艦ミサイル部隊と地対空ミサイル部隊、これをセットで置くというのはもうずっと以前から決まっていた計画であります。
So the plan which Defense Minister Kishi announced in August about deploying the ground-to-ship and ground-to-air units on Ishigaki was something which had already been decided from long before, actually.
日本にはその防衛計画の大綱といって、日本防衛の骨太の指針があります。で、この防衛計画の大綱が2018年に安倍晋三政権の下で改定され、現在それが実施に移されています。
And so Japan's basic defense policy is based on the policy which was set forth in 2018 under, or was revised at the time by the Abe administration. And this 2018 revision is now what is being implemented.
2018年の防衛計画の大綱では、鹿児島県の奄美大島、そして沖縄県の宮古島、この2つに、石垣島に置くのと同じ地対艦ミサイル、そして地対空ミサイルの部隊を置く計画があって、もうすでに奄美大島と宮古島にはそれらの部隊が配備をされています。
And within this 2018 plan it also has the deployment of the same ground to air and ground to ship units as planned for Ishigaki-jima, also in Amami-Oshima in Kagoshima Prefecture and Miyako-jima in Okinawa Prefecture. And the deployment in these two locations has actually already been made.
そして石垣島への2種類のミサイル部隊の配備が、日本にとって南西諸島の防衛の最後の総仕上げになるということです。
And it is said that the deployment of the two kinds of missile units on Ishigaki Island is as the last stance of the defense for the Nansei Islands on the part of Japan.
もちろん日本の防衛計画の大綱は仮想敵というのを定めていません。しかしながら 警戒するべき相手は、中国であるということは明らかです。
And within Japan's defense plan, of course, it does not set out a specific hypothetical enemy in these scenarios. However, it of course does have China in its sights.
これらの南西諸島におけるミサイル部隊の配備は、中国から日本への侵略を抑止をするというのが第一義的な目的です。
And the first or the initial goal for the deployment of these missile units in Nansei Islands is for preventing or protecting against a Chinese invasion of Japan.
しかし中国が日本を侵略する意図があるというのはどう考えてもあまり合理的ではありません。
However, it is not, we cannot really think about any logical reason or logical expectation that China would plan any kind of invasion of Japan.
そこで台湾との関係が出てきます。
And this is where the relationship with Taiwan comes into play.
今年の4月に初めて日米首脳会談、これは菅首相とバイデン大統領との間の初めての日米首脳会談があり、その中で日米が台湾海峡の関について関与していくということで合意を一致しました。
And this April, there was, of course, the first summit meeting between Japan's Suga and the United States' Biden. And within this, they referred to, or they agreed upon the engagement in the Taiwan Straits.
すると、この南西諸島に配備をされるミサイル部隊の役割は、台湾と中国、そして中国とアメリカの戦争が起きた場合に、アメリカ側にとって有利になるように、中国の軍を抑止をする、もしくは具体的に武力行使に出る、そういった役割が持たされているというふうに理解してもいいと思います。
And so within this context, we can understand the deployment of the missile units on the Nansei Islands or their role, first of all, as looking at in a potential conflict between Taiwan and China, but particularly looking at a scenario of war between China and the United States for assuring that there could be supremacy for the perspective of the United States in regards to deterrence against China as well, or even potentially as the site for concrete armed action.
したがって質問者のお考えの通り、台湾の問題と関係があるというふうに言えると思います。
So as in the question, I believe that this is indeed intended for or connected to the relationship or the positioning of Taiwan.
私一つ、ただそれを抑止力として考えた場合に、自衛隊のミサイルは海の上にいる船をやっつけるミサイルなんですね。そして今アメリカ軍が持っている多くのクルーズミサイルもそういう洋上の船を相手にするものなの で、そういう抑止なんていうかそういう戦い方で本当に間に合うんだろうかというね。それはつまり中国の虎の子である陸上からのミサイルサイトを潰すこと、潰すにはちょっと能力が足りないミサイルなので、本当にそれで完結するんだろうかということも、私は疑問に思っています。
However, to add, when we're considering from the perspective of deterrence, the missiles of the self-defense forces of Japan are, of course, ship-based as well. And the majority of the U.S. cruise missiles are also ship-based or, you know, towards those which are also ship-based. Therefore, when we consider whether this kind of fighting would actually happen, whether this kind or the capacity of these kind of missiles would be enough to target the ground-based missiles of Taiwan, is something I would actually question.
そしてもう一つ言えば、アメリカ軍はそのいざ戦争になったときに、今のように、クルーズミサイルで中国の船を全部やっつけるというようなプランを持つことで抑止力になると考えているんですね。ところが日本の人たち、特に日本の政治家は抑止力があれば戦争にならないんだからミサイルが飛んでくることを考えないでいいと思っている。そのギャップが非常に私は問題だと思っています。 すみません、余計なことを付け加えます。
So, and to add one further point as well, I think from the perspective of the US, they consider deterrence as in the case of a war happened, how to be able to use its cruise missiles in order to attack the Chinese ships, how to have a plan in place for that is what the US sees as deterrence. However, Japanese people, and particularly Japanese politicians, see, or their perspective is that if deterrence is in place, then this will mean that there will not be any war. So we don't need to consider the scenario of missiles being targeted towards Japan. I think there is this gap between the understanding of deterrence on the Japanese and US side, which is an issue.
Okay. Thank you. We have another question online. This is from Motoko Rich at the New York Times. Her first question is for Mr. Yanagisawa again. The second question is for Saruta-san. The first question, how can Japan work to make sure that China protects human rights? Or do you not consider that part of Japan's diplomatic role?
あの次、ニューヨークタイムズの元子リッチ記者から2つほど質問が届いています。まず1つ目は柳沢さんへの質問、2つ目は猿田さんへの質問なんですが、まず柳沢さんに対して、まあ、日本が中国に対して中国が人権を守るようにどういうふうに働きかけることができるのか、もしくはそれは日本の外交的な役割ではないというふうに考えられるのかというのがまず1つ目の質問です。
その人権を守るということと人権を我々が外から何らかの影響力によって人権を守らせるということはね不可能なんだろうと思います。で、その人権侵害に対する制裁とかねそういう強制力を使うことはあるけれどもそれで中国の状況が変わることはないだろうと私は思います。
First of all, in regards to human rights, I think there is a difference between protecting human rights and making someone, making China protect human rights. And I don't think that it is possible for us from the outside to force China to protect human rights. When we look at, for example, there are different methods such as implementing sanctions against human rights violations or coercive measures as well. But whether they will actually achieve or lead to any change in China, I don't believe that that is the case.
もうアメリカはすでに中国が、中国がやがて、なんていうか民主的でノーマルな国社会に変わるという、願望をもうすでにアメリカは放棄したように思いますけれども我々はやっぱりそこ の, その中国社会がどう変わっていくかっていうのはもっと長いスパンで見ていかなければいけない。それは中国の人たち自身の選択の問題であって、外から強制して押し付けるわけにはいかない問題なんだろうと思っています。
And I believe that the US, in a way, has already abandoned hope of China becoming a diplomatic so-called normal society or country. However, from our perspective, I believe that it's very important to look at how Chinese society needs to change on a much longer span as well, and to recognize that this needs to be, it will need to be the choice of the Chinese people rather than being something forced or implemented through coercion from the outside.
しかしそれは、だからその人権をめぐって意見の対立は当然あるし批判はすべきだと思うけれどもそれを理由に戦争をするようなことを避けなければいけないということが一つだと思います。
However, this does not mean that there should not be any clashes of opinion over human rights, and of course Japan should also be critical of Chinese human rights situation as well. However, using this reason as a reason for conflict or a reason for war is something which must be avoided.
それからもう一つはやはりこの社会が変わるということ、私は中国の政府が変わることは何にも期待してないけど、中国の社会が変わることを考えたときに、やはり我々日本が、日本でもアメリカでもね、やっぱり民主主義の方が暮らしやすいよねっていう、なんていうか、これはそのモデルを押し付けるという意味ではなくてね、本当に中国の人々がああいう社会であってほしいと思うような社会に我々自身が、なっていかなければいけないというそういうその時間のかかるプロセスなんだろうというふうに私は思います。
And one further point, I think if we look at, well, I don't necessarily have any expectations of the Chinese government changing, but as we look for how to have societal change within China as well, I think that it's important for them to be able to look at, well, Japan or the US and so on, and see that it is easier to live in a democracy. This is not about forcing any particular kind of model onto China, but for the Chinese people themselves to see the kind of society that they themselves want to live in. This will, of course, be a very long-term process, though.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you. The second question from the New York Times was Saruta-san. You emphasize the importance of people-to-people ties between Japan and China. Do you believe that Japan's strict border controls during the pandemic are undermining those efforts, particularly with regard to universities who have admitted Chinese students but cannot obtain visas for them to move to Japan for study?
そして次、サラダさんへの質問なんですが、スピーチの中では日本と中国の間の人々の交流の大切さ、重要性を強調されたんですけれども、日本がパンデミックの間にその入国の制限を厳しくしているということは、その努力には悪影響があるのか、また特にですね、具体的には日本の大学で中国からの留学生の入学を認めているんだけれども、その留学生がビザをもらえないというような状況がありますが、そのような状況についてのコメントをお願いいたします。
Thank you very much for the question, and thank you very much for Richie-san, you know, for the question. So we haven't seen each other for a long time, so I hope we can see each other again very soon after the pandemic ends. Then regarding the people's connection, we understand that it's very, very tough right now to meet with people, to talk with people in person, then have a conference. You know, even we have a conference right now, you know, press conference with a few journalists kindly attending, but still lots of journalists are joining only through internet. I cannot see people's face, people who are making questions to us. So we are losing a little bit connection with the people even attending this conference. So, you know, I'm teaching at the university, Rikkyo University. I'm a lecturer at the Rikkyo University. I had a class last year, but I didn't even see any single student of myself. I just gave a lecture through Zoom. That's the reality. So you're right. I think it's not very easy to make connections. But still, when we see the Japanese society, we have lots of Chinese people in Japan, or still we have a lot of international marriage, or we have lots of goods and, you know, the products from China. So of course, I understand the situation is very difficult, but still we cannot cut the tie with China, cut the tie with any other countries in the world. Then, you know, these small connections usually don't speak out loudly, but when it comes to the conflict, it speaks a lot, I think. If you have a friend, you know, it looks like a very kind of naive talk, but still, if you have a friend who is from China who is very good, you don't want to have an attack on the country or the city or town from where the friend comes from. So, you know, these are small things, but, you know, in Japan, there is a kind of, I would say, like, between Japan and China, we have been enjoying a very long relationships through people's, how do you say, like, come and go connection. Japanese government and Chinese government couldn't have a very good relationships, not right now, but also for a long time. But still now, people's connection change a lot. So lots of small groups, or sometimes big groups, have try to encourage people's visiting China, welcoming Chinese people to Japan. So that is a foundation of our country. So we shouldn't forget about the importance of such a small things, but accumulation of such a small things, that is big. So the situation is not easy, but we are neighboring countries. You know, we cannot move out from this region always, any time. You know, China is just there. We are here. So we cannot forget about it. Then we cannot forget about the such a small things. Accumulation is a big thing. Thank you.
Can I just follow up on that, if I may? Because Japan has a much, much longer, as you've just indicated, history with China that goes back centuries and centuries. So how do you sort of capture that in a sort of a diplomatic sense, beyond the hawks, beyond China's wolf warriors, this human-to-human communication that you speak about. I mean, do you see your organization, the New Diplomacy Initiative, as being part of giving voice to that, to try and counter the hawks and wolf warriors, so to speak?
一つまあそれに関連する質問なんですけれども、今の話にもあったように、日本はやはりもう何百年も続く中国との長い歴史、長い関係があります。それを今のまあ政治の中での高派などを超えて、外交の分野でその人と人のまあコミュニケーション、つながり、交流などをどういうふうに外交の分野で生かしていくことができるのか。またはND という団体が、まあ、そのようなそのカウンターするような声という一部になるというようなことを考えていらっしゃるのかについてのコメントをお願いします。
Thank you for the question. Then we would like to be, if possible, you know, bridge builder between Japan and China as well, not only between the United States and Japan. Then we ourselves would like to have a lot of meetings, a lot of, you know, study sessions with Chinese scholars or Chinese politicians. But not only that, you know, when we see the history, for example, we had a, how to say in English, like a friendship treaty between China and, China and Japan in 1972. At a time, government had hesitated to have the friendship treaty for a long time since the end of the war. However, first the business people started the relationship and made a pressure on the Japanese government to have it, but still government, you know, had hesitated to do it. But the next, the lawmakers, politicians went there then to have the lots of conferences and try to see people in person, visit China. So the business people and the lawmakers and finally the government, of course, after the United States started, but, you know, the government decided to have the friendship treaty with China. So we are closely working with the lawmakers as well. So we could make a pressure on the government or the lawmakers, politicians, to at least maybe not the high rank level, but just the general lawmakers can visit there, then, you know, or maybe have a Zoom conference with the Chinese people. So these kind of incident or these kind of, how do you say, communication is something we can encourage them to have. So step by step, we will do that. And also we will make pressure them on doing that.
Okay, thank you.
Does it make sense? Hopefully.
Yes, yeah. It was rather a vague question, I realized, but yes. Do we have any other questions from the floor? Yes, sir.
Yeah. 東京新聞 OB の吉村と言いますが、最近ですね、ASEAN のリージョナルフォーラムというのが開かれました。その席で、日本の茂木外務大臣がですね、こういうことを言ったと報道されております。アメリカと中国は軍備管理で、対話をすべきであると。日本としては積極的に言ったつもりかも分かりませんけれども、ただまあ歴史を振り返ると、まあ主要な軍縮条約とか軍備管理協定っていうのは、まあアメリカと旧ソ連ロシアの間でまあ結ばれてきたわけで、その前提となるのはその核弾頭の数とかですね、あるいは核運搬手段の数、質、そういうものが均等であるというようなことが一つ前提になってきたと思うんですね。それで、まあ、今中国が非常に急速に軍事力を強化していると言いますけれども、アメリカとの間には大きな開きがあると思うんです。で、現実に両国がですね、そういう軍縮などで話し合える、可能性があるのかどうか、柳沢さんでも本田さんでもお答えいただきたいと思います。よろしくお願いします。
I'm an OB
copy of the Tokyo Shimbun at the recent ARF, which was held by ASEAN. The Foreign Minister of Japan, Mr. Motegi, made a statement calling for a dialogue on arms control between the US and China. As to whether Japan would actively be involved in that, that is a question. But if we look at history, the main different disarmament treaties or arms control agreements, for example, those between the US and US's former Soviet Union, for example, have been agreed or had as a basis looking at reducing to an equal number of nuclear warheads, for example. Looking at the situation now of China, which is said to be expanding its arms, for example, and there is this widening gap between the US and China as well. I would like to ask either Mr. Yanagisawa or Mr. Handa your perspective on if you believe that this kind of disarmament dialogue, arms control dialogue, would be possible between the US and China.
はい、ありがとうございます。半田さんからも専門的なご意見はあるかもしれませんけど、言われたように今アメリカと中国そしてロシアというファクターもありますけれど、それぞれが違うものを持ってるんですね。つまり中国からアメリカ本土に届くミサイルの数はアメリカの数より圧倒的に少ない。しかし、さっき半田さんの話にあったように中国から東京とかグアムに届くミサイルは圧倒的に中国がたくさん持ってるわけですね。このその、非対称な形のなんていうか兵力組成がなかなか軍備管理にとっては難しい。まあ今の状況ではなかなか軍備管理というふうにはのベースができにくい、そういう状況だろうと思います。
Mr. Handa may add some expert opinion after this as well, but as you mentioned, of course, there's the US and China, and we can also bring Russia into the equation here, I believe, as well. But if we look at the current, the arms which each of these are holding, for example, if we look at missiles, as Mr. Handa mentioned as well, if we look at the number of longer-range missiles, which could, for example, reach the US from China, the number that China has is, of course, many less. But if we take the intermediate range missiles which could reach from the Chinese mainland to Tokyo and Guam, for example, there is much more supremacy on the Chinese side in regards to the number that they hold there. So there's a very asymmetrical situation in regards to the arms and missiles and so on which are held by the different parties, which I believe does make it rather difficult to create this common base for this kind of arms control dialogue between the countries in the current kind of circumstances.
どうすればいいかっていうと、一つだから中国がもっとたくさん ICBM を持ちなさい、そしてアメリカも日本にもっとたくさん中距離ミサイルを起きなさい。でそれが、パラレルになった時にね、軍備管理ができるのではないかという考え方もないではないわけですね。
And as to what should be done then, well, there is one view which says that, well, then China should have more ICBMs and the US should then deploy more mid-range missiles in Japan. And this would create a parallel situation between the two countries, which would make this kind of arms control or arms reduction conversation possible. That is one view which exists.
それはもう冷戦の時代に経験してきた、まさに核兵器による恐怖のバランスの上に平和が成り立つというようなね、その試行錯誤をもう一回繰り返すのは私は愚かな選択であると思っています。
However, this would mean a repetition of what was experienced during the Cold War in regards to looking at the fear of nuclear weapons, the balance of nuclear weapons is what leading to peace. I believe that repeating this kind of situation would be very foolish.
ただ一つやはりアメリカとソ連が軍備管理軍縮の話を本格的に始めたのは、あれはケネディ政権の時のね、1960何年だっけ、キューバ危機ですね。ああいう私は台湾海峡をめぐっても何か米中の戦争に至るような大きな危機が多分あるんだろうし、でそういうものがない、そういうものを経験しないとね、なかなかアメリカも中国も、冷静な話し相手にはならないのかなという、そういう若干その半分悲観的なシナリオを今私は描いています。
However, when we look at when the concrete arms control dialogue was able to begin between the US and the former Soviet Union, this was under Kennedy when there was the Cuban Missile Crisis in the 60s. And I think that we may see a similar situation in the Taiwan Strait, where we may see coming on the brink of a war between the US and China, which could lead to a similar situation, actually. And without such an experience, I do wonder whether it will be possible to indeed have calm dialogue between the US and China towards arms control. Of course, this is quite a pessimistic way, perhaps, to look at this, but this is one thing for consideration.
まあ、ちょっと手短にお話ししますけど、アメリカとソ連の間で核軍縮が実現をしたというのは、やはり核兵器の数や、あるいはヨーロッパに配備をした中距離ミサイルの数が、まあ、均等になっていた、まあ、その大前提があるということだと思います。
And as a brief response, I think that also the reason that the nuclear disarmament dialogue was realized between the US and Soviet Union at the time was when they did reach the equal number of, for example, nuclear warheads and also mid-range missiles which were deployed in Europe.
で、現在の米中を比較すると、まあ、核弾頭の数でアメリカは5500発、で、中国は350発程度しか持っていません。
However, if we compare the US and China situation at the moment, for example, the US is thought to have 5,500 nuclear warheads, whereas China has 350.
で、地上配備型のミサイルについては、核であれ、非核弾頭であれ、中国が1250発で、アメリカがゼロ。
And as for ground-based missiles, whether nuclear or not, China has 1,250 and the US zero.
これを均等にするためには、例えば中国が核弾頭を増やすとか、アメリカが中距離ミサイルを増やすとか、まあ、そういったやり方が一つありますけれども、これはいずれにしても、まあ、軍拡というほかないです。
And there is, of course, the perspective to look at, well, then, an increase in Chinese nuclear warheads and an increase in US mid-range missiles as one way to bring equity or equality between this situation, but that is, of course, leading to this arms expansion.
でそうした軍拡競争について米中以外の域内国である日本や韓国や ASEAN そして域外国である欧州の国々もそういった状況を歓迎することは決してないと思います。
And whether the countries, first of all, in the region would welcome such an arms race between the US and China, this is countries, namely Japan, the ROK, ASEAN countries, and so on, and even the same for the Western countries or countries in Europe as well, of course, that would not be the case. This would not be welcomed.
柳沢さんの言った結論にかなり近くなっていきますけれど、この台湾をめぐる米中の緊張関係がさらに高まっていかないと、この話というのは落としどころが見つからない恐れがあるというふうに思っています。
And the conclusion comes quite close to the conclusion which was drawn by Mr. Yanagisawa as well. But unless the tensions between the US and China over Taiwan increase even more, become even more tense, then I think it's very difficult to find where these disarmament talks or where this kind of exit could be seen.
その代わりの手段としては、域内国であるアジアの国々、日本を含むアジアの国々および域外国である欧州の国々がもっと強く米中に対して働きかけをしていく、まあ、そういったことをやらない限りはこの問題は解決しないし、それでさえ二大国に対するその還元としては非常に弱いものかもしれないので、私はあまり楽観的には考えることはできません。
And indeed, the method which is there for the means available is for those countries within the region, that is the Asian countries, including Japan, in cooperation with also countries outside of the region, to have a stronger voice or stronger sort of lobbying towards the US and China. And also, without resorting to that, or even doing that, I think could be somewhat weak in order to have an impact, to have an influence on these two superpowers. However, I believe that this is indeed the what needs to be done, although this is also not necessarily such an optimistic view.
Thank you very much to our speakers today. We have come to the end of our time now. I think it was the US President Theodore Roosevelt who coined the term about diplomacy of speak softly but carry a big stick. And I think any efforts to continue the speaking softly and to avoid the threat of military conflict is to be welcomed. So If you'll join with me in thanking our speakers today with a round of applause, thank you very much.